So we have this bound, right? Okay, now let's see. My input parameter to the algorithm is what? We said that is going to be the M, right? Where is M? What is M? M is the number of place of each of the arm before I commit to somebody. Okay. Now, how should we select this M? Suppose if I select M to be small, is it good? Why? Right. So, if your M is going to be small, we are not going to have enough samples, right? So, because of that, the estimates may not be good, and with few number of samples the estimate with them, if you commit to one arm, maybe that may not be the best one you are going to get, right? Because you have only few arms, maybe the estimates may not be good, and because of that, the one which is the best one may not come up with empirically best. Somebody who is not actually best may end up empirically best, and you may end up playing that for the rest of the duration. So, it is going to be bad. Why not then choose M large? Suppose we set M to be large, yeah, we have large number of samples, we have a very good estimate. After that, we will commit to a good arm, but before that we have wasted so much of time in collecting the samples, right? When you are collecting the samples, you may be also, you are also collecting bad samples. So, you have been wasting lot of your time to identify that. So, both of them are not good, right? Then how to choose M? That is exactly captured in this bound also, right? Suppose you choose M to be small, this quantity is going to be small. So, this is what? This is basically the loss you incur in the initial exploration phase. So, this part comes from the exploration part and this part from come the commit part. If you choose M to be small, this guy is going to be small, but what about this? This can be potentially large, right? Because it is already saying that this probability, if you have small number of samples, this probability can be large that you will end up making a mistake. So, because of that, the regret you are going to incur, the expected regret you are going to incur in the commit phase can be larger. On the other hand, if you want to make this guy small, the only way you can make this guy small is make this M large. If you are going to make this M large, then this guy is going to take a hit, the regret you are going to incur in the exploration phase. So, you see that already one, we have to balance this, how to explore, how much we have to put our resource in exploration and how much we have to put in our expectation. So, then how you are going to choose this M? M is an input, right? You see that if I increase M, this guy is going to take a hit. If I am going to decrease M, this guy is going to take a hit. So, why do not I treat this M, even though M is an integer, I take this bound as a function in M and try to optimize over M and try to find a value that minimizes this upper bound, right? So, can we do that? Just so here M is a linear quantity here in this, right? And here this is exponential in M, anyway this is going to be convex, but this is quantity is decreasing in N. So, see that this is going to be, let us say, convex function in M, you need to verify that, and then let us say it is going to achieve minima for some particular M. Can we find that M by just differentiating and equating it to 0? What is that value? So, if you just treat it as variable in M, differentiate and find it, what is the M you are going to get that maximizes this. So, okay, before that, so this is going to make a slightly complicated, right, this term, because this I know is going to, I mean, right now I say you verify whether this is a convex function, but we do not need to even go there. Let us say we know this guy is convex, right, only the exponential minus of M. But this product with this, I do not know right now whether this is going to be a convex function. So, let us simplify this. Instead of that, I am going to make it an upper bound where I will just ignore this term and just take an n here, simplify this. Now the second term, the only m dependency comes in this part, right? I have removed this m and I got an upper bound. Now I know that this quantity here, the second term, is also convex in m, right? Because exponential minus of m, it is a convex in m if you treat m as a continuous. So this is convex, this is linear, so this guy is now convex function. Just differentiate it and find what is the m that minimizes this. So if you just differentiate it, you will going to get in m to differentiate and equal to 0, okay. So let's make one more simplification. Let's take this k to be simply 2. Let's assume there are only 2 arms, okay. So then the expression here becomes what? Now because I have only 2 arms, the first quantity del 1 is going to be what? By our definition, what is del 1? It is going to be 0, right? And I will have del 2. So in this summation here, it is going to be del 2 plus n times del 2 times exponential minus and also in the summation, I only need to worry about the second term because the first terms make this entire thing 0. So I have now, we get this simplification, and if I now want to equate it to 0, this can get rid of, and then if I am going to optimize find solution for this, then m is going to be 4 by delta square log of okay. So this is at whatever the value is, but now coming to m, I want it to be an integer, right? Even though I differentiated it treating m as if it is m is a continuous variable, but m is an integer. So what I will do is whatever the value of this, I am going to take the seal of this. So even that value happens to be a fraction, then it is going to give me some integer value, okay. And also, is it possible that this quantity inside this seal can be negative, right? So what I am doing is this, what is the inside n delta 2 whole square by 4, right? Suppose this delta 2 is so small such that this quantity here happens to be less than 1. If this quantity happens to be less than 1, then what we are going to get? Sorry, less than 0, less than 1, then log of that quantity is going to give you negative value, right? So negative value means the seal is going to be what? Seal of a negative value. Some integer, right? But some integer value, but I want m to be at least 1, right? Because m is the number of samples. So what I will do is I am going to redefine this m to be max of 1 times So, for the 2-arm case, what is the best way to set this m? It is like this. If you are going to set it like this, okay, now let us plug it back in this. If you are going to plug it back the value of m in this expression, you will end up with so I am only doing it for the case when k equals to 2. Already written there. So if you simplify this, I am directly writing after simplification, you can verify this. What is that? Four by. So, you are getting reciprocal of this. Yeah, I think it is actually reciprocal. I made a mistake. No, I think the inside is n delta 2 by square. It is okay, right? This is what we have written. So, this is what the finally after putting back this value of m in this expression for the case k equals to 2 you are going to get. But I think there has to be some correction here, this quantity. So, finally, if you are going to plug it back the value of m like this, you will end up this quantity. And you will see that how is this regret depends on n? So, okay, let us say, so if I just simplify this, this upper bound ignoring all these terms, I am just going to keep the ones which are relevant. So, this is the exact expression, but I will just simplify this. So, you will see that now this regret is logarithmic in n, right? Yeah. Yes. We don't know. We will come to that. So, I am just saying that somehow if you are going to set m like this, you are going to get a regret bound which is in this fashion if you just plug in. Okay, so now just look into that. Now, this regret bound how it is like in n, this is logarithmic in n, right? Now, coming to what he is saying, fine, if you are going to set an m like this, good. you have ended up with a logarithmic regret like this, which is definitely sublinear. But to set an m like this, what you need to know? Delta 2, right? So, what is delta 2? That is the gap between mu 1 and mu 2. Even though my current algorithm does not know which one is the optimal, arm 1 is optimal or arm 2 is optimal, but what is need to know? The separation between them. That is delta 2, right? So, if it knows separation between them, it now can settle exactly, like it can know how much to explore and then when to start, when to commit, right? So, then it is natural here, right? Does it make sense? Like, why, if I tell the algorithm what is the gap between the first arm and the second arm, that is the separation between these two, it kind of decide, right, when, how much samples it need to explore. This is because it has to estimate the parameters, and if it already knows that the separation between them is delta 2, all it needs to ensure is the accuracy with which it is going to estimate the parameters, that accuracy, that error happens to be less than delta, right? So, again, what we are saying, this delta 2 is mu 1 by mu 2. So, what my algorithm is doing is, my algorithm is estimating mu 1 hat and mu 2 hat, okay. Suppose it is able to estimate, now I know that somewhere mu 1 is here and mu 2 is here, sorry, mu 1 we are assuming to be larger, right. So, mu 1 is here and mu 2 is here. And the gap between them is, we are going to call it as delta 2, right. Suppose my algorithm estimates the mean value such that the whatever the estimated value I have, that the true value of this mu 2 will be contained within that delta 2, around this, within delta 2 approximation. So, instead of delta, let us make it delta by 2. So, that it will be whatever my estimated value is going to be below this, and whatever my estimated value of mu is above this quantity plus delta 2 by 2, right. So, if this, I can estimate my mu 1 hat and mu 2 hat within delta 2 by 2 approximation of that true value, then I know that when I am going to compare this with this, I am not going to make mistake. Okay, so let me rephrase this. What my algorithm is doing? My algorithm is estimating mu 1 hat and also it is estimating mu 2 hat, and it is finding which one is the bigger one of these two, right. Now, I know that the true value of them, that the true value of this mu 1 and mu 2, the difference between them is delta 2, okay. Suppose if I have this mu 1 hat here and I, let me estimate this guy within delta 2 by 2, So now I know that my true mean is somewhere in this interval with high confidence, right? Like I know, like with some confidence it is going to be. And then I have another mu 1, mu 2 hat, which is also like this. And I know that my mu 2, the true value of mu 2 is again going to be within this interval with high confidence. Now, if I am going to compare these two quantities, their separation would not be more than, they will be at least separated by a distance of delta, right? And that is also the actual separation between mu 1 and mu 2. So, because of that, if I can know the true difference between mu 1 and mu 2, I can a priori decide to what accuracy I should be estimating my mu 1 and mu 2. And now here we are saying, okay, if the true gap is between mu 1 and mu 2, so again coming back to this, I know that this gap is delta 2. If I can ensure that my estimate of this mu 1 2 somewhere falls below this and my estimate of mu 1 remains above this, then when I am going to compare the estimates, their ordering will not change, right? So, because of that, the one with the highest mean will be declared as the highest mean if I am going to estimate those values within this delta by 2 error part. So, that is why once I know my delta 2 and it is saying that if I am going to set my m to be this many number of samples, I am going to make a very small error, only this much of error in fact, what is that exponential part where we remove, yeah, this much part of the error in separating these two through their estimates. Okay. So, naturally as long as I tell you the actual values differ by certain amount, that will kind of already give you a hint to what accuracy I should be estimating each of these arms, right? And that is what it is saying, like, okay, if you are going to set m like this, I am going to set my number of samples like this, with this I will get a error bound which is of this format, which happens to be leading to a regret, which is logarithmic in n here. Okay, so good, we have logarithmic regret here in n, but the bad part is I need to tell you what is this delta 2, right? To set m in this fashion, that is I need to tell with the difference between arm m, sorry, if it in the two case itself, like arm 1 and 2, what is the gap between them I need to tell, but we may not know this a priori, right? All we are assuming that each of these arm have certain distributions, we do not know those means, so we also do not know what is the gap between them. We are interested in algorithms where we even do not want, we do not have this knowledge of this, even without this can we get something like this, some regret bounds which are logarithmic in n. Okay, so what other options we have there? We have this explore then commit algorithm, which said that yes, if you tell me the gap between the best arm and the suboptimal arm, I will somehow give you suboptimal regret, but I need extra information. What is that extra information? I need to tell you this delta 2. If you tell me delta 2, I know exactly how many rounds I need to explore, and after that I will do a commit, that commit will almost identify the right arm with high probability. So then this exponent commit needs to tell you the gap between mu 1 and mu 2, right? I do not want that. What other options I have? Okay, other possibility is called epsilon greedy, or maybe just greedy. So what is greedy? You just go and sample each arm once, and after that you just, or maybe instead of once, maybe sample each one of them certain number of rounds, and after that commit to the one which has gives you the best empirical arm. Is that that is greedy? After that, in every round you just you the one which gives you the empirically best, you play that and you see what reward you get. In the next round you update all of them means and play that. That is a greedy version of this, right? Instead of committing to one arm after certain number of rounds, you explore initially and after that you start playing an arm greedily. In every round you pick the one which has the highest empirical mean. Will that be good? Why? So why not, if etc explore and commit algorithm has brought you this level, with some knowledge of delta 2 you can get a logarithmic regret, why not if you continue to do greedy instead of committing? Why not? That's a bad idea. Okay, so if I start doing greedy in every round instead of exploring, I just get sample from each of them once and then start doing greedily. Is that a good thing or bad thing to do? Okay, you understood my question? You are going to sample each arm once and after that you start selecting the arm greedily in every round. Yeah, you take anything you want and see in which case it is good and is there a case where it is going to be bad. Yeah, so along that line, suppose let us say again take the two case. Arm 1 is simply, let us say Bernoulli some value p 1, let us say it is just half, and let us say arm 2 is Bernoulli 0.8, okay. Which arm has highest mean in this? Arm 2, right? Its mean is going to be 0.8. Suppose you pick one arm, one sample from this and another sample from this, okay. And in that case it may happen that you may get sample 1 from this and sample 0 from this, right? It is possible, okay. Now because of that, when you want to play in the second round, which arm you are going to pick? You are going to pick 1, and it may happen that again you get sample 1 from that, okay. And now, and in the third round what you are going to do? Okay, just forget this. So I am going to write, let us say in the first round you got sample 1 from this and 0 from this. Then what you are going to do in the second round? You are again going to choose arm 1, right? And what you are going to do, and you did not get any sample from this. So now you have only one sample from this which is 0, while from the other samples you have got from arm, you have at least one. Whatever the average you are going to get, your average will be greater than 0, right? So you will be always playing then arm 1, you will never get to arm 2 even though it has highest mean. So because of that, if you are going to do greedily, you are never going to get the optimal one. It is pretty much possible that you will miss out the optimal one, and because of that your regret could be linear. So the other option is you don't play the empirically best in every time, you know that you could be missing the other ones. So every time before you, every time you, with some probability you go and explore, okay, because of that you may end up in this case maybe also playing this one and get a sample from this, and because of that your average about that could improve. Then the question is how to set this epsilon, right? Okay, so how to set this and how this algorithm going to work, you will do it in an assignment question, and there we will ask you to discuss how to choose this epsilon and derive some regret bounds like this for it. Okay, let's stop here.